Glad to have you back. Now, the Islamic Movement of Nigeria has continued to protest against the continued detention of its leader, Ibrahim El-Zakzaki.
Now, the protest for the freedom of the Islamic leader, El-Zakzaki, took a new turn on Monday when the group took its protest to the National Assembly to raise alarm that the health of their leader had rapidly deteriorated.
The group tried to make their way into the National Assembly complex but was resisted by security personnel. The policemen guarding the complex released tear gas on the group and were supported by the Nigeria Civil Defense Corps in chasing fleeing demonstrators and passers-by who struggled to breathe amidst the thick fumes. And joining us via phone from Kaduna is a lecturer at the Ahmadu Bello University, Professor Abdullahi Denladi. Good morning to you, Professor.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, thank you for joining us. Of course, we still have Dr. Dan Ekere in the studio. Thank you for staying on.
Thanks.
So let us start with you, Professor Denladi. What kind of example is this administration given by the continuous detention of El-Zakzaki, whose freedom has been granted by the court?
Well, that says it's loud and clear that it's a government that does not obey the rules that of its court. You can see a federal high court here in Abuja has granted him release and he's enforcing his fundamental human right of freedom, but the government is denying it. He's not the only one. A number of cases in the Nigerian society today, people are languishing behind bars and detention because the government does not owe up to its obligation of obeying the rules and regulations of the courts and rulings. So it's very unfortunate that we're living in a society that's supposed to be democratic, where people are not even upholding the principles of democracy, which are supposed to ensure justice and equity so that people will be free to practice whatever they so wish.
All right, Professor, let me ask you, is the Shiite movement, are they misunderstood? It seems a lot of people don't really know what they stand for, especially those who are outside of the northern region. Are they misunderstood by Nigerians and even the authority?
Well, I believe that I can agree with you to some extent. Yes, some people tend to misunderstand what the... it's not the Shiite movement, it's an Islamic movement, right? Anybody that appears to you, that is a Muslim, is automatically a member of the movement, only that if you so come to identify with us and join the struggle to see to the establishment of divine justice and eradication of wickedness of the leaders and corruption, then definitely he is a member of the Islamic movement. Sometimes, the propaganda meted out against Sheikh Zazaki and the movement tend to cause a sort of misconception or misunderstanding from the audience, even up north here, coupled with the fact that yes, I agree with you to some extent that this issue of Shiism and Sunni is something that is embedded in the history of Islam. Mm. Right from day one, the issue of leadership of after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came up. Those that believe that the companion of the Prophet had the right to choose who should be his successor are leveled as Sunni. Those that believe that there is a divine injection stating who should be the successor of the Prophet are called Shia. So there's this, and you know, here in the Nigeria, majority of the Muslims here are Sunni. And this antagonism between Shia and Sunni has been in existence for over 1,400 years back. So they will use all these kind of things to sort of becloud the understanding of the Shiism and the Shia as well. So these are some of the factors that may contribute to sort of the misunderstanding that I believe you are talking about.
All right, Professor, we'll get to you in a bit. Stay on. We'll still talk to you in a while. Dr. Dan, really, the Garba Shehu, one of the special assistants of the president, said that Ibrahim El-Zakzaki is in voluntary custody for his own safety and in company, that's the word used, in company of his wife and children. That, in fact, if he's released, it could be more to that. It's not because he's going to be a threat to the public, but some people could even want to attack him. So,
well, Garba Shehu is doing his job as a special assistant, senior special assistant to the president. he has to protect his job. But he knows within himself that he's lying. Because ex-Azaki has not volunteered to be in your custody. The man said he wants to go home. And you are the one. What do you call voluntary custody? Who volunteered to be in custody? Is it the man or the government has volunteered? There are a lot of people who want to be in custody to be taken care of. Government is not prepared for that. Why is it that the ex-Azaki who wants to be on his own is the one you've decided to volunteer to keep? You see, let's be realistic. To start with, the clips we saw, you know, with respect to the event that led to his arrest, as a matter of fact, were quite, annoying. A situation where a group of people would take laws into their hands and say, this road, you can't pass through this road. A road that they did not build themselves. All right? Because the report we had was that the chief of army staff was actually on his way to a particular function. And there was this, you know, activities.
Yeah, religious activities.
Good, going on in a particular area. And they told the man and his entourage that you can't take this route. You need, as if it was their road. That was bad enough. Not only that, they even attempted, because from all indication, it shows that some of them were armed. They attempted to even, because they threw stones, some fired bullets, and in the process, you know, the army, opened fire eventually. So it was a combat. I think that was bad enough to make such, and if that is what the Shiites are known for, I think it's a very bad tradition. However, it is not enough for the army to take laws into their hands. You see, they have a duty to protect lives as well. You know, for as long as your responsibility is to secure the territorial integrity of the country, what do you call territorial integrity other than the human beings? Yeah, you are securing territory for the people. If the people for whom you are securing this territory are the ones you are going to kill, then obviously that territory is meaningless. So we must have respect for lives. And in any case, this is a case that is already in court. The court has not said you should keep this man in protective custody or in voluntary confinement, as you are calling it. The court has granted, you know, this man bail. So I expect that the government should respect, you know, laws to the extent that if we choose to run this country the way, you know, sometimes it is being done, just like the case of the former PDP security advisor, what's his name?
The National Security
Advisor.
National Security,
yes.
Who has been in custody.
So you find that they have this strategy, this government in particular, have this attitude of, you know, violating laws, even when a court of competent jurisdiction has ruled, has granted bail. They refuse to. So, on the case of Ex-Azaki, now the people are saying that the man's health is deteriorating.
Okay.
So, if you want to convince the public that this man is enjoying his confinement, then let the public have access to him.
Okay.
Let the media go there and focus on the man. Let the man equally address Nigerians as well. I'm comfortable here.
All right. Let me bring back Professor Danladi on the line. Now, Prof, the report we get is that Ex-Azaki is not in a very good condition of health currently. And there are fears that anything could happen. Now, even though it's not wished to be that way, but if we play a scenario where in case anything happens and Ex-Azaki dies in custody of the government, what kind of scenario could play out eventually, especially looking back at what happened at the leader of Boko Haram and so on?
Well, before I respond to this question, I would want to make some observation on the comment of our guest there. Actually, what if somebody studies the scenario of what happened right from that day one when that when this unfortunate incident happened, you will understand it is a total setup. Because right before the coming of the chief of army staff, military had been stationed there, and in fact, it is just a setup. But one may not understand the scenario perhaps on simple 12-minute discussion. But suppose there was a road blockage that stopped him from passing, right? Okay, it was enough that they have cleared their way. Then what took them to his house? What took them to his mother's graveyard? What took them to the graveyard of our graveyard where Matthias Avari? What took them to our institution, our libraries, all to destroy just because somebody's road is blocked? Even if somebody's road is blocked, is that the punishment to kill all people, over 1,000 people? There are rules and regulation guidance of the society. Now, that put aside, on the issue of Sheikh health, definitely his condition is very worrisome as it is now, because right from when he was shot severely, his left eye was blown off with the bullet. He has metal fracture in his right eye, which he may be going blind any time unless divine measure or appropriate measures are taken. And he has been known to be hypertensive, a 67-year-old man with the leadership of over 20 million people in his mind. Definitely you can understand the kind of stress. Now that he's suffering from a stroke, he cannot walk, he cannot stand, he has slurred speech, he cannot even pray standing, he has to sit down. And yet, the government is refusing him access to proper medical care. They are busy rushing themselves and their children outside the country to get treatment. The ophthalmologist that examined his eye from the beginning of this problem confirmed to us and to the government that his right eye could be salvaged, but right now in this country there are no facilities to do that. Since then, we have been pleading with the government to allow him access to go and come back. After his medical treatment, he can come back and continue to be in their assumed protective custody, which that one in itself is a mere delusion. You cannot give somebody against his wish. You cannot give somebody against his will. Right now, while he's staying, he's only paying for his food, his clothing, his shelter, I mean, his light bill, his water bill. Even yesterday, they attempted to confiscate his phone. All this on protective custody, and that he voluntarily appeared to be, I mean, to be with them? Certainly no. So we pray that Allah will not allow him to die in their hands. But certainly it's not going to be a good scenario if anything of that nature should happen. Because it may be difficult to control the people when you have such large number of people supporting somebody whom they believe, whom we believe is our spiritual guide, and then suddenly he's being killed. And then those that kill him will just go about their normal activities, and then life will continue as normal. I believe something may be, I don't know, but we pray that he should not reach that stage.
All right, Professor, please hold on. And that is the fear, really, because it's majorly the difference between the Shiites and the Sunnis. The Sunnis believe that, yes, anyone could be given leadership or the bloodline, but then the Shiites attach sainthood to humans, to persons. And that is the fear, that if anything happens to this man, his followers who have been bold enough to even face security operatives in Kaduna, in Abuja, despite being tear gassed almost on a daily basis now, could react, and there could be a blowback, especially in the north.
Are
you worried?
Reacting. They are even reacting to the detention. So is it death they will not react to? Obviously they will react. But let me ask, which of the groups does the Chief of Army Staff belong? Because obviously he's a Muslim. Is he an opposite or what do you call it?
Sunnis.
Is he a member of the Sunnis or the Shiites? So I don't know where he belongs, because if that is what is playing out, then he need to be addressed. But in any case, you see, this man need to be given at least his freedom temporarily. Let him appear in court to defend whatever. If you feel the man has committed a crime, there are proper channels of dealing with this. He didn't commit, you know, a crime in the army that you now do court-martially and what have you. This is a civilian, for God's sake. And you feel this man has committed a crime, it must be a crime against the known laws of the land. Now try him in line with that. If the courts, the competent courts where he's supposed to be tried, one of them has declared a judge or has made a pronouncement, at least obey it. Now, you go ahead until the case is concluded. Should he be found guilty of whatever crime, the necessary or the appropriate punishment will be meted to him. But the situation whereby you just, you know, keep people in detention, you don't even consider their lives, you don't consider the aftermath, what could happen, should anything happen, does not augur well for this society. Yeah, I'm not a Muslim. I wouldn't know how the bodies operate, which one is that, you know, but I feel that as a human being and as a Nigerian, the man has a right to live.
And even looking at
and he has a right to religion. He has a right to association.
The constitution provides
has a
for all of
the
those.
Fact that you took him, his wife and children there, does not mean you've taken every bit of his family there, because he has extended family
followers.
That he relates with. He has followers, he can't relate with them. So the question of custody, that nothing is happening, is involuntary custody, does not arise. Because you can't fool the entire country. We know that the army is notorious for this kind of thing. They molest people. These are people who are paid from taxpayers' money. And they just believe that because they have guns, they can do whatever they like. Mm. You see, they should know that it is even a law that instituted the army. Mm. They just wake up one day and say, oh, we are the soldiers of Nigeria.
Okay.
So they must operate in line with the rules of engagement.
Okay. Well, we have to end this here right now. Yes. Dr. Daniel Kere of the University of Lagos, thank you very much for coming on
thank
the program.
You. Thank you. The pleasure.
And Professor Abdullahi Danladi of the University, Ahmadu Bello University, yes, joining us from Kaduna. Thank you so much for talking to us on TVC Breakfast.
Thank you. Thank